Hey everyone, it is Wednesday, and you know what that means. We bring back your favorite expert, Anna Kelly. How you doing, Anna?
Good morning. I'm great. How are you, Michael?
I'm doing very, very well. So we're going to record this first section Wednesday, but actually post it Thursday. And this is because I want to hear from Anna what she's thankful for, right? We're a day away when we record this from Thanksgiving. It's often a day for reflection. You and I reflect a lot normally, but I wonder what this year, both kind of big picture, but also in your life, right? You've done some amazing things this year. You closed on a massive beach house. You bought your dream home for your family. You were part of a syndication in a couple of different spots. It's been a tremendous year for you. And then we got all this other stuff going on. So I'm when you think about this, Anna, what's Anna thankful for?
Oh, Michael, I'm thankful for so much. I really am. I'm just, how can I not be, you know, thankful for so much. But as I really thought a lot about this year, I really have to say that I'm thankful for the struggle that led up to all the great things of this year, because we have years when it seems like, you know, so much is going right. And we have years that are just really hard and so much goes wrong. And during those hard, lean years, when you're starting out, you know, there's a lot of times that you question yourself and you think, what am I doing? And is this really going to work? And should I stick with it or should I give up? And, you know, how long is it going to take when bumps in the road happen that kind of derail your ideal plans? Mm-hmm. And this year I've been able to really look back and go, oh, that's why I went through that. That made me strong and wise for today. And those things are what led to all the great things that I've had happen this year that I'm so thankful for. So I'm really just thankful for, you know, the journey of life, and that all the hard work pays off. It doesn't always pay off in your timing, but you can see, you know, really for me, I can see God's hand in it, kind of preparing me for the greater things that were on the horizon today that I couldn't see when I was struggling 10 years ago and 5 years ago. So I'm thankful for struggle and process and growth.
It's amazing that you said that. You actually used the same word, because I brought this question to you today because I was asked it yesterday.
Oh.
And I said basically the same thing, right? When you step back out of it, and you remove yourself from thankful for your family, the health, you know, all of that stuff that I know is important to you, right? Yeah. And you step back and look at the bigger picture. I had the same thing. I was thankful for the struggle or the fire that, you know, both I had as a teenager, right? Again, both you and I came from very humble beginnings. Yeah. You can come out of that environment usually one of two ways. I came out where I will always be able to tap into that reserve of pain and memory. And I'm not going back, right? And then the whole struggle, my first 8 years of being a real estate investor is like, I don't even know if this is working, because we just kept buying more stuff. I'm like, where's this freaking cash flow? Because I don't have any, right? But everything's breaking. Yeah. Ah,
for sure.
So yeah, it was funny that we both use the same word, struggle. And I think people need to hear that, right? They look at where you and I are now and we talk about what we're doing and it's all amazing. But we both point back to, we were forged in difficult times.
Yes.
And some of you are going through difficult times now. Realize this will be something that will either break you if you let it, or it will, I don't know what it is, make you stronger.
Thank you. Yeah.
And you just need to hear that.
Yeah.
It's and okay.
I think Michael, because yes, this year's had some big challenges and, you know, it's derailed some of the things that I thought I was going to do, and it's made, you know, home and navigating kids with school and online and all that, you know, challenging. But I think when I can look back and see in the middle of all those challenges were great things that I've always dreamed about, that I'm like, how can all these great things happen in 2020, a year with a lot of stress? But I can look back and go, you know, there's beauty that comes through patience and that takes time. But seeing all the great things make the hard things like, we'll get through it. Because when you've been through enough hard things and you realize, you know what, you get through it,
and you can
choose to become better for it. So you kind of said it'll make or break you. You can either get bitter or you can get better. And so the more challenging things I go through, the more I'm able to go, you know what, too many things are beyond my control. I'll focus on what I can control. I'm not going to grumble and complain. I'm going to choose to be happy and count my blessings and figure out my way out of the fire that we're in and the challenges that come, knowing and trusting completely that I'm going to be better for it. And next year is going to be better. And the next year is going to be better. Yeah. And so I'm just thankful for sometimes the perspective that comes through seeing that you turn out okay, even through challenges, makes every new challenge not seem like that big of a deal, even though we're in the midst of a pandemic that's disrupting our lives.
Yeah. Again, folks, for the folks that are watching this, you know, this might be your first bad cycle, right? You and I are old enough to remember the dot-com crisis, which I was in tech. That crushed us, right? I was at a tech company who had just filed their S1, which is obviously, you know, a filing to go public. I was looking at a liquidity event in the seven figures because I was a very early employee. 9/11 happens. That basically takes the IPO off the table. We shrink revenues because nobody's buying. And like in 3 months later, I go from a seven-figure exit to having lay off half the employees, right? And we struggle for another year or so and ultimately sell the company for pennies, right? So that was rough. I went from making $200,000 in the stock market day trading essentially to losing 80% of it. The Great Recession crushed our net worth. I mean, again, when you're in the middle of it, I guess what I'm trying to say here is it feels bad. It feels like it will never end, but I want you to know it will end. And I think that's specifically important today because we are in some dark days. I believe Congress has utterly failed us to complete the bridge with the second stimulus or the fourth, depending on how you want to count it, for the unemployed and PPP, right? For the people that need it, stop bailing out Wall Street, right? They have failed Americans, I believe. And that means, well, when you don't build a bridge all the way, some of us go off and it's painful. But as bad as it says, as bad as it is, it will end, right? And we will get to April, we will get to May, and that it will be brighter. But I just want people to hear it. It does suck. It's hard for us too. You will eventually build calluses. And I would tell you to remember this time. Let it harden you. Don't let it break you. Because I'm sorry, you will have another recession. You will have another thing. You know, we both hopefully have 50 years or more left in life. We will probably have three or four more bad cycles. We just have to be ready for it. Any thoughts there?
Yeah, 100%. And I think, you know, again, just because we've been through some of the dark times and the easy times, and it really, you know, there's a proverb, and I don't know exactly where it is, but there's a proverb that talks about, you know, the fact that, you know, we shouldn't store up all of our treasures on earth because it's moss and rust can destroy. And it's like, yes, I'm still buying property. We're accumulating. We bought a nice house. We bought a nice beach house, but I've also known what it is to grow up in the projects. I've known what it's like when we were starting out to sell our home and to house hack and move, you know, with four of us into a two-bedroom apartment. And guess what? We were content. So I've learned that as much as I'm buying things, it's not the things that bring me joy. I mean, I'm thankful for all of them and I'm thankful for those extra blessings. But you know what, Michael? And I said this to someone I was talking to yesterday. I'm so grateful for the stuff, but I'm more grateful that the stuff has allowed me to make memories. So if you focus on your family and memories, and listen, COVID is making us all spend a lot more time together in our house. And we can either choose to get at each other or enjoy the memory of being together. And so I've really thought a lot about what if the market tanked and we lost all of this? Yeah. And you know what? I would be content. I wouldn't be happy to lose my house. I wouldn't be happy to lose those things. But what's really important in life is our health and our family and spending time with the ones we love. And for me, even if we lost everything, let's say the market did collapse in the next couple of years and we're back in a depression, it's going to stink. None of us are going to like it. But you know what? If we have each other and we choose joy and to make the best of everything we have, we can have joy and be happy and be grateful despite the economy, despite politics, despite what we do and don't have. And so sometimes it takes being through those hard things to recognize that, you know what? Life isn't about all the stuff and a good market and a president we like. Life is about what we make it. And I'm grateful that this year I've had a lot more time to spend with my kids, with my spouse, with, you know, our family, making memories.
Yeah.
And those things don't go away no matter what chaos is going on around us. So I'm grateful for that.
That
I've come to that realization.
That was a big change for me too, is not stuff, but memories. I mean, until I was 30, it was all stuff, right? Go get the new widget, the new thing. It was pretty crazy. I have a wild question that I never thought I would ask. So when your family's together and you're going to play a board game, do you have a favorite board game as a family?
We have different favorites.
Ah.
Full disclosure, someone starts crying no matter what board game we
play. Okay, fair enough.
Mommy likes cash flow and Monopoly because I always win, and some of the kids don't like that. I'm really good at games. I love games and I like to win. The kids don't like me to win and I don't like to let them win, but I do sometimes. I like cash flow, and the kids, we have cash flow for kids. My kids actually really like that game, as long as they're winning. We have every version of Monopoly, you know, surprise, surprise. We have Ms. Monopoly, which my girls just love. The guys are like, this is a man bashing. It's not fair. The women get an advantage, but Ms. Monopoly is so fun. You should play it with your wife and daughter.
I will.
We have Ocean City, Maryland Monopoly. So we kind of like that. We like Pictionary.
Ah.
And one of my still favorite games, I don't think they make it anymore, but Starbucks came out with Cranium. Have you ever played Cranium?
I have. Yeah, yeah.
And they have different modules. So we like ones that you can kind of do different things. And there's another one that we play. It's called Bananagrams. It's kind of like Scrabble.
Okay.
And it's letters and you got to spell words and different things. So we really like those games.
Very, very cool. Anna, thank you very much for being a part of the Expert Series. You are the OG, the original. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And this will be a highlight of Thanksgiving episodes.
Thank you. And happy Thanksgiving. We have so much to be grateful for. And I'm grateful for you. I'm grateful to be a part of this and the difference that you're making through one rental at a time.
Thank you.